posies, a pocket full of posies. Ashes, ashes, we all fall down.
I want to do it again.
I know you do. Merry Christmas and easy entertaining from my deep brown kitchen. Oh my God, I'm When we first started talking about sharing entertaining and holiday cooking tips with PBS viewers, I stumbled a little bit, really for two reasons. One is that I've always worked all holiday season long, and aside from cooking Christmas Eve dinner, have never really done much holiday entertaining outside the restaurant. The other thing is that things that are obvious to me as a professional chef are not necessarily things that home cooks understand and practice on a daily basis. So it was really helpful to see your questions to help me determine how we should frame this information session. One from Mary Ann says, do you have a method for binding a cheese ball with minimal or no mayonnaise? Another question, which also pertains to this, is from Alex. Our kitchen is under remodel and we will be kitchenless this holiday season. Do you have an easy appetizer, holiday side dish, or dessert that requires little to no baking? So I love the idea behind cheese balls. You know, it's almost so cliche, it's cool. And this December we started doing one at the restaurant that's really elevated in a sense. And it also happens to be the number one seller of all December. People are going crazy over it. So I'm going to show Alex and Marianne how to make a cheese ball. And really all you need is a bowl and a spoon. You don't have to have a food processor, but it certainly does help. So when you're making any kind of cheese ball, especially one without mayonnaise, which I, by the way, don't love mayonnaise and cheese balls either, you want to make sure that all of your ingredients are totally room temperature. I think there's often some misconception about what room temperature is. These have been sitting out for about 2 hours, and so they all need to be really soft, really pliable. And when you eat a cheese ball, it also needs to be room temperature so that you can enjoy the creaminess and all the flavors pop. So first, I'm gonna start with some chopped dates. They're gonna add nice sweetness. You know, chopped dates are great to add that sweetness. You could also do raisins or cranberries. Any chewy, dried, sweet fruit would be perfect. And to that, I'm gonna add some cream cheese that is very soft. And I have very high quality, unsalted butter that is also very soft. I'm gonna start by just blending these three elements and kind of making them homogeneous. I just wanna make sure that the dates really get incorporated before I start adding all my other ingredients. You know, you can go to Christmas parties and there can be very, you know, cerebral, cool party snacks out on the table, but I guarantee the first thing that's gonna be eaten is that cheese ball. So don't hate on it. I'm gonna add some punchy cheese flavors that are really gonna brighten this up. So I've got Maytag blue cheese. This is a really, you know, high quality, delicious, assertive blue cheese that we use quite a bit in the restaurant. And then I have some fresh goat cheese, which has a nice round tangy flavor. It's gonna kind of balance the blue cheese. And I'm just gonna give this another little whirl. Now I'm gonna add the things that kind of stand out. I've got some pecans that have been roasted and salted. And I have some scallions because you really want to balance all this with some bulby notes. And I'm just gonna kind of pulse this a few times just to incorporate it. You don't want to blend up the scallions and the pecans. You want them to be the texture inside your ball. I'm gonna add a little pinch of salt as well. I'm gonna turn this out into a bowl. All right, so I'm gonna let this set up in the refrigerator, and while it does, I'll answer some more questions. Hey, Ben, you wanna be a part of this for just a few minutes?
Do I get to eat the cheese ball?
Not yet. This is from Danny. Vivian, there's a disagreement in our house over cooking everyone's favorites for the holiday meal. versus doing a unified menu of things that complement one another? Where do you stand?
Cook your favorite thing.
Really?
Yeah.
But I feel like so often there's, you know, just too much stuff. Like growing up, we had, you know, rice casserole and mashed potatoes, you know, and sweet potatoes.
All right, so I've been eating with your family for 10 years now, and we eat that way at every holiday, every time somebody cooks. And I don't ever remember somebody saying, I didn't enjoy that meal. There wasn't enough, there was too much stuff.
Obviously, Danny, we have the same controversy in our household.
Yeah.
But you know who really determines that? The person cooking. All right, Ben, here's another question that speaks to really your background more than mine, from Carmen. My question is, in your opinion, what is the best way to cook a large standing rib roast, approximately 18 pounds? We did one last year for Christmas and we'll do one again this year. It was good, but I would like to get your take on it for a consistent medium rare throughout. And what seasonings do you recommend?
Well, I'm certainly no expert on standing rib roasts. I usually call my dad for advice. I think growing up, we had rib roasts on Christmas Eve. Ours was always cooked to rare, because that's how my grandfather liked it. And they'd slice it, and they would put all of the sliced meat on top of white bread. And my favorite part as a kid was eating the blood bread underneath the meat.
That's gross.
It's delicious.
The blood bread.
But I think, you know, for medium rare, you want 23 to 25 minutes a pound. But we usually just did lots of salt and lots of pepper.
Yeah, you want salt and pepper, and you definitely want it to sit out at room temperature. And a lot of instructions say, let it sit out at room temperature for 30 minutes. But that's in no way enough time for an 18-pound rib roast to come to room temperature. I mean, we're talking about 2 hours. And you want to make sure that the ribs are separated from the roast and tied back on. So when you go to slice your rib roast, it's not a bloody, ugly mess. Because we have had that happen.
And also you want to be able to eat the bones.
Yeah, you want to be able to pick them up and chew them.
Chew the bones.
This is from Katie. Viv, can you share your favorite ways to celebrate with seafood? Of course, we prefer North Carolina seafood. Well, one of the things that my family always does, and a recipe that I'm developing for this year's Christmas Eve spectacular, is oyster dressing. You know, I think oysters are in season, fall and winter in North Carolina, and they're a way to really elevate your typical dressing or stuffing. Okay, this question is from Linda Mills from Tampa, Florida. She's actually my aunt.
Hi, Aunt Linda.
Hey, Aunt Linda.
Hey, Randy.
Your question made it. How do you make turkey gravy from your cooked turkey? And then she signed it, Aunt Linda. Well, we always roast turkey in a roasting pan, and then you have all these nice, beautiful drippings. And so you want to roast your turkey. Take your turkey out of the roasting pan and let it rest on your platter. Then take that roasting pan and put it directly on your range. So basically gravy starts with a little roux. So you take the drippings from your turkey, add a little flour, get that working in the pan over medium heat, and then you're gonna add the stock and a little cream, and it'll come up to a boil, and that will all kind of thicken up. And then you thin it out as you like with more stock, more cream, and then finish it with butter. And then you end up with a really delicious gravy that came from the drippings from your pan. I think there's all sorts of misconceptions as to how to make turkey gravy, but that's really the easiest one.
How do you keep it from getting lumpy? Because I think that's a problem that I always had and a lot of home cooks probably have.
Well, I think a lot of home cooks make gravy like this. They have their stock and their, you know, flavoring components at a boil on the stove, and then they add their roux. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then that just creates lumps. You know, if you start with the roux and you add your stock in slowly, whisking the whole time, you're very rarely going to end up with lumps. All right, Ben, thank you very much for participating this morning.
You know, I love being an expert.
Thank you. One of the questions is, Vivian, I'd love to know what traditional dishes must be on your family's table at Christmas. Also, what new dish or two will you sneak on the table this year?
Ham, collards, and turnips.
Those are the things that you always have there, but we never ate growing up.
Well, I'm going to have them this year.
I think this year we'll do a beef, and I want to do this thing called a corn ham. You know, always do something crazy.
No. When I was young, we always had a corn ham.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. Why haven't you ever mentioned that?
I don't know where they get it, where they corn it at. I mean, it's put in salt. Mm-hmm. You have a great big pot to put it in.
So we're going to do that this year.
So you'll go back to my childhood and your daddy's childhood and our early marriage.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you, Mom. I know Dad's about to die to get to lunch. If he doesn't eat right after church,
he gets ill.
He gets very ill.
He'll wait for me.
All right. Thank you, Mom. Mm-hmm.
You're welcome.
All right. So my cheese ball, I just brought it out of the refrigerator. Chilling it, not only, you know, hardens it up enough so you can form it, but it also allows all the flavors to marry and to become one with the cheese ball. So I'm sure there's a more glamorous way to do this. Basically, I've just, with clean hands, am going to form a nice round ball. And you know, you can roll your cheese ball in anything you like. The one at the restaurant, we are dehydrating country ham and crumbling it up and rolling it in that. But if you're gonna do this at home, it's much easier to buy bacon that's been sliced thin to cook it crispy and then crumble it up. So in essence, you're making bacon bits. You can just roll your little cheese guy in here. And because we have the blue cheese and the goat cheese and the scallion, the bacon and the pecans all in here, it makes sense to me to pair this with a fruit preserve. So I'm gonna put a nice puddle of my pear preserves on the bottom of the plate. And then I'm just gonna set my beautiful cheese ball on top of my pear preserves. So I asked my dad to pick up some television-worthy crackers this morning at the grocery store, and he came back with saltines and said those were the only crackers he knew. So we're gonna spread saltines around our cheese ball. Cheese ball! Thank you all so much for submitting your questions. I had a great time answering them and I actually learned a lot. Happy holidays. I can't believe I just made a cheese ball for TV.